You cannot trust adults. Especially ones that wear masks, okay? Clowns, out of the question. Five years old, the next year, I was at my best friend's house, and he told me, I told you guys this story of the children. So at his best friend's house, he told me, if you want my dog to like you, you need to come over and pet it. I lied to my mother for probably 15 years about what really happened. She thought the dog attacked me. It was my fault. I went over there to pet the dog. But I went to pet the dog because I trusted him, and his dog bit me. And I told you, dogs don't have tonsils, right? Realize that you can't trust your friends either. Shortly after that, I stepped on a piece of glass and went from the bottom of my foot to the top of my foot. I had to go back to the doctor. Didn't like doctors. So, what I was learning is that you can't trust anybody, you don't talk to anybody, and holding that inside started to turn into anger. And as a little kid, there was this battle that would always go on of being sweet or letting this anger come out. And if you're the littlest one in your family, don't let the anger come out because your brother's getting it. They hit you, you know what I'm saying? You get picked on, you get beat on. So, what do you do with all that? What do you do with all that? You just push it inside. Push it inside, push it inside. Now, there's a thing called a train, okay? In my life, it's called the crazy train. And the crazy train is where you put all this stuff that you're holding inside, that you push down, and you push down, and you push down. When you're a little kid, you get one boxcar. And there's a lot of room in that boxcar, and you fill that boxcar up, right? And you build a wall around that boxcar, and you don't go back there. Well, that thing gets filled up, and then you just add another boxcar. So you fill that stuff up, you fill that stuff up, you fill that stuff up, you start adding these boxcars. By the time you move down here to Florida, I remember being in elementary school, and them taking me out of class and bringing me to the office, and they were like really serious. Now, I was in the principal's office on a regular basis. We were friends. I was really friends with his paddle more than him. But he was a nice man, and he handled discipline the way a professional should. You did something wrong, you got paddled, he talked to you afterwards. So it was a man, he was actually talking to me, that usually didn't happen. So, like I said, he called me in, and it's like, well, I must have done something really bad. This is going to be really bad. But they told me, your grandfather died. And it's like, it took me a while to think of, who are you talking about? Why is this important to me? Because we went to his house, he never talked to me. You weren't allowed in the same room with him for very long. You went down to the basement, and you played down there. Okay? So, I really didn't have a whole lot of interaction with the adults. If you were around them, you had to be quiet. I was not a quiet child. Nor was I one that could sit still long. So, here we now are going to start to deal with death and loss. And it's like, well, I didn't really know him that well. It didn't really matter. But other people were having emotions. Didn't really care. And that's how, from that point on, I grew up. Realizing that if you cared, you got hurt. If you showed these feelings inside, you either got made fun of, or people didn't listen to you, or it didn't matter anyway. Nothing was going to change because you're a kid, you have no control over anything. And as I continued to go through school, started to realize that there were issues and problems with how much the other kids learned and how much I learned. How well they spoke and how well I did not speak. Come to find out, when it came to math, I could not do it. Had teachers that tried to teach you, but they had a bunch of kids in the class, so you just, if you couldn't do it, you just got left behind. Had teachers actually told me I was stupid. And I realized that early on. I realized that I knew the smart kids, I was friends with them, because I could learn stuff from them. Plus, usually some kids didn't pick on me, they got picked on. But with them, all this is leading up to, again, how I was viewing my world. I became a very angry child. And I carry that anger to this day, and I'm going to explain to you why. This is even after being converted to Jesus Christ. This is why this is important. When you continue to have people tell you that you're stupid, your friend's parents say, yeah, he's a nice kid, but he's not going to, you know, come anywhere. After a while, you believe that. And you start looking and going, well, what are my options in this life as I grow up? What I realized is that if you made people laugh, they liked you. So I was really good at making people laugh. Also, I figured out very quickly that making people laugh, making them like you, you can control them. And I've learned how to manipulate people. And I also realized that if they think you're dumb, they lower their defenses very fast and allow you to come right in. So, with all of that, I got into my teenage years. I used to get taken home by the police. We shot a cop car with a BB gun. I didn't do it, my friend did, because I shot the other car before him. The cop caught us. Joey Ennis, do you remember him?
Oh, yeah.
Joey Ennis, cop took him home first. He didn't show up for school for 3 days or 4 days because it took that long for his bruises to go away. Because his daddy took care of him. I came home and I think my sister was the only one there, and so the cop took me, drove me around, let me play with his lights, and gave me a lecture. Probably the only man in my junior high years that actually did anything like that. And I realized, again, that there was something inside of me that was wrong. I knew how to be nice. I knew how to be polite. My friend's parents loved me because I was very polite. But they had no idea what I was leading their kids into. Some of them figured it out, stopped that friendship quickly. Others, they had no clue. And started doing drugs by the time I was 13. And that continued to progress until I was in my 20s. And in that time period, I told you kids that there's a specific time frame of your life where what choices you make is going to determine the rest of your life. The choices you make in this small gap of your life, and that's from 12 up to about 16 or 17, is going to determine everything else you're going to do to the day you die. And in that time period, I had ran away from God. My mother taught me from an early age that God was real, that God heard and saw everything that you did. Her words were, I may not see you, but God sees you. We were good Catholics, okay? So, I knew that God was real, and when I had nobody to talk to, he's who I talked to. And I talked to God all the time. What you need to realize is that a lot of my conversations with him weren't nice. My conversations with God was, why are you doing this to me? Why are you letting this happen? Why do I have to deal with all this pain? Where are you at? Because see, I didn't really want a God that would change my heart. I wanted a God that would be a genie to do whatever I wanted. Same? And God, in His mercy and in His grace, showed me that that's not who I am. And if you want me, then you get all of me. And I control it. And so I ran away from God. And I ran so far, that I had to do drugs to allow me to sleep at nighttime. Because my conscience would bother me so bad that I hated who I was. I hated what I've become. I knew that if my mother knew what I was doing, that it would break her heart and she wouldn't have respect for me. That actually broke my heart more than what I've done to God, is what I thought she would think of me. It got to the point one night I was so mad at God that I laid in the middle of the road crying to Him, shaking my fist at Him, telling Him I hated Him. That's anger. I can either take that anger out on Him, or I could take it out on another person. And I knew that if I took it out on another person, I'd be in really big trouble. I tried. I tried many times to take it out on other people. I started martial arts when I was 13. And I stayed in martial arts for a long period of time. And I didn't like karate. Karate is actually empty-handed combat. Didn't like the style, didn't like the rigidity of what they taught. I went into kung fu. You know what the definition of kung fu is? Think about this. Wisdom, the way, always learn. I had turned away from God, and I had put my focus on a false religion. A religion of fighting and a religion of humanistic thinking. Wisdom, the way, always learn. When I started getting deep and deeper and deeper into kung fu, something started coming back into my head of, listen, true wisdom comes from the Word of God. I learned that from the Catholic Church. The way is Jesus Christ. He is the only way. What martial arts taught me was how to take all this anger that was inside of me and all this pain and channel it and focus it to accomplish what I wanted. It taught me how to be very calm on the outside, while inside I was a mess. It taught me how to manipulate and control people. It also taught me how to intimidate people. Now look at me. Do I look intimidated? Okay? I'm the same size I was in high school. But my buddy can tell you, don't get me angry. Because it's not a nice or pretty sight. Why? Because I know what is inside. And I lived that way until I was about 22. I got kicked out of college. I wrecked my car. I had to go back and live with my mother. And I needed to get a job. So I went down to Glen Abbey, because there was the golf course and there was a land developer. The land developer paid more money. I went down there to talk to this man to get a job. I had long hair, I had earrings, and this man thought I was a hippie. It had nothing to do with me. But I would go back there every week and talk to him. He wouldn't give me a job, One day, I took my niece with me. She was, how old do you think she was? 4. She was the cutest little girl ever. Went down there with her, talked to him, never told him this was my niece. He assumed this was my daughter. He gave me a job. Okay? And so, got that job there, and that's where I met my wife. We worked at the same place. I had no car, had no transportation, and used to have different people take me to work every day. Sometimes I could always get to work, sometimes I couldn't get home.
Okay. You ready for this?
Yeah?
Okay.
So, at that time, my wife did not like me. It wasn't just, well, I don't want nothing to do. She did not like me at all. And I'll give you examples. One day I didn't have nobody come pick me up, so I'm walking home, and I'm still in Glen Abbey, and her and her husband come in their car. And I walk up to the car, and she is right in his ear. I get up to the back, and he takes off. Just like in a movie, takes off. I knew what that was about. They lived on the property, so at lunchtime we'd go over to their house. She'd set the table for everybody but me. Didn't take long to count how many plates there were. And it's like, okay, where do I sit? So it was cool because I got to sit with her son, who was four years old. Again, cutest little kid ever. And not only that, but he had the most awesome toys of anybody that I ever met up to that time. And I still like to play. So they ate, they had adult boring conversations, and me and him sat in the living room. And we played with his stickers. He had every WWF wrestling guy, and he had the ring to play with him in. He would give me the stickers, and I would keep them. When I got a motorcycle, I used to put them on the gas tank of my motorcycle. Me and him became really good friends. And I realized then that I love the way children think, and I love how they view their world. And hanging out with him helped me deal with all the things inside. Because you talk to a kid, it's like I said, you talk to adults, there's layers in talking to adults. Do you understand what I'm saying? And you have to push through those layers to figure out where this truth is. But him's just innocent. So I fell in love with him, and we used to play and we used to wrestle all the time. Then, like I said, his mother somehow, some way, had a different opinion of me at some point. And she saw that maybe I wasn't as bad as what she thought. And we got married. But when we got married, there was a lot about what's inside of me she didn't know. There were things about her I didn't know either. But I always had to control this anger. Always had to control it. Burning rage that's inside. Once we got married, I realized that I needed to change my life. I had a kid now, I had a wife, and I needed Jesus Christ. I could not continue to live the way I was living. Not because of them, but because of what was inside of me. I hated who I was. And I hated it. I hated all the drugs. I just hated it. I had said the sinner's prayer dozens of times. You know the sinner's prayer? After every radio preacher, they give me the invite for Christ, say the sinner's prayer, boom! It's supposed to change your life. I said that a dozen times, two dozen times. Never did anything. It's like, why? I knew why. It's because I wasn't ready to give my heart to Christ. I wanted to be free from this pain. Christ wanted me to be free from the sin.
Amen.
Okay? I wanted to hold on to that sin so that I could control it, and I just wanted his forgiveness. Do this for me and leave me alone. And Christ said, no, I don't work that way. Finally got to the point where I couldn't take it anymore. And in my kitchen, I knelt down one night and I prayed sincerely. I didn't say the sinner's prayer. I talked to God and I asked him to change me, to take all this away. And I meant all of it. You know what God did? He took a part of it away. He took the worst part, the part that really needed to be changed at first. He took all that. Those were outside behaviors, right? All the outside behaviors. He took care of that. If God would have showed me everything that needed to be done on the inside, I would have committed suicide. I gave my heart to him, I was studying what churches that I should join, where I should be a part of, and that's how I came into the Adventist Church, because I had studied every mainline Protestant church's doctrine, and I compared it with Scripture, and there was just a lot of questions that they couldn't answer when it came to Scripture. And as I started studying with the Adventists, I started studying with Adventists and Jehovah's Witnesses at the same time. I told you all this. And I would just, both of them knew their Bible. And so I would take the Jehovah's Witnesses verses and bring them to the Adventists, and bring the Adventist verses to the Jehovah's Witnesses and see what they had to say. And the thing that I started to realize is once I stopped doing drugs, that I could actually remember things and remember spiritual concepts. And so I would be asking these guys and asking these guys, and we would spend hours. Eventually, the witnesses never stopped coming back. But the Adventist guy, he was tenacious. He kept coming back. Gave my heart to Christ, joined the church. Was in the church, came in through a revelation seminar. The next year, I was helping teach that seminar. Again, I could remember things and repeat them. Word for word, didn't know what they meant, but other people could understand it. Had all this head knowledge and no heart knowledge. And what I found when I came into this church were some really dedicated, loving Christians. And I also found people that they were even worse than the people that I left on the outside. Christians, you guys don't take care of your wounded. You eat them.
Amen.
Okay? I came into the church, and I came from a background of just a mess. And just because of my background, people didn't like me because they thought I was a bad influence. I mean, they didn't know me. And then they got to meet my children, my son, and they really didn't like us. One day the pastor was in his office, and I didn't know that I knew he was from South America, but I didn't realize they'd have their own language. And he was speaking on the phone, and I'd never heard him speak with this dialect before. And I used to do a lot of LSD. And I thought I was having a flashback. I thought, I turned white, and I started sweating because I thought I needed to go to the hospital. Because I never had this happen before, to that extent. And he'd come out of his office, and he looked at me and said, "Man, what's wrong with you?" And I explained to him. And he didn't know my background. And I told him, and he hated me. Hated me. Not just dislike, he didn't like my wife either. He didn't like us. And he made our lives very hard at the church. And now I'm a Christian. And I'm still dealing with all this stuff that I dealt with on the outside that I thought would change about people and trusting them and thinking that they would love you and find out that they don't. And how do you deal with this anger now and you can't show it? Because you've got to be a Christian. You know what I'm saying? You've got to act a certain way. And what I found is that I had become a Pharisee. I knew all the rules. I knew the right way to talk. I knew the right way to dress. I knew the right foods to eat, but what I didn't know was Jesus Christ. And I told you that one day in the hallway, this man got into an argument with my mentor, and I wanted to take him outside and choke him. Now, when I say that to you, I mean that literally. And, you know, I stood there by his side because if he would have made a move, and that's all I needed was just a movement, because that was my training. How he handled this man, how he showed Jesus Christ, showed me that what my reaction was wrong. And that I needed to know Christ the way he knew Christ. And that I needed this relationship with him the way this man had this relationship. And he helped me with that. I went to the Deland Church, got to meet another man named RJ, who he had the opportunity to make a judgment on me. He had the opportunity to do that, and how he handled it. He handled it with grace, and he handled it in the love of Jesus Christ. And this man showed me. This man was the first one to really show me what you do when people attack you. Because as I got to know him, and as I got to know the passion of his heart for the gospel of Jesus Christ, and I got to see the attacks that he had been under for a long period of time and how he handled it, he showed me that there was hope, that there was hope for me, that there was hope for how I would deal with all this inside. That if he could do this and he could stand strong, and that he could continue to have love in his heart for these people attacking him, then maybe I could actually have love. Just love. Do you know what it's like to go through decades of not really having love, deep love? You fake it. Faith of love. There's always that something missing. That what was missing was Christ. My mother died. I watched her pass away from cancer. All of her children went through this journey with her from beginning to end. My sister and I were in the room with her the night she passed away. My mother taught me everything, showed me everything. I loved her more than I loved anybody else. And I watched this disease just take her to nothing. I watched her stay firm in her faith, stay firm in her love for her God, and realize that this isn't the end. That after this, she will see Jesus' face. There will come a day when we will all be together, and there will be no more pain, no more sickness, no more sorrow, no more death. But that we can spend eternity together in a world that has no more sin. My sister and I were in a room the night she took her last breath. I had the privilege of performing her funeral. I didn't cry through the whole thing until the interment at the end. But that was only because people were staring at me funny. I have learned how to control emotion. My wife used to tell me when we were first married that I was very cold, and she was right. I could be of that. How do you deal with all that when you come into a relationship with Jesus Christ? How do you deal with that when you start moving up in authority within the church? What do you do when people are looking at you and you realize that what's inside of you and this crazy train that you have that you're not letting go of? You're supposed to be this and you're not. You don't live up to what the expectations are. What do you do? I found out that what you do is you turn to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Jesus Christ said, as I said earlier, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus Christ showed me what love really is. That it's not just something that I manipulate or I control, or I give when I want to. But love is pouring yourself into other people, whether they give that love back or not. Pouring yourself into others who hurt you. Pouring yourself into others. If they had the chance, they'd kill you. Brothers and sisters, as this is, as I said, the last sermon that I've been giving here, thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for these last 10 and a half years. What I want you to get from this is victory in Jesus. Is it possible?
Amen.
Look at my life, what I told you, where I'm at now. What changed my life? When my mother died, that broke my heart. Deeper and more powerful than anything else that has ever broken my heart. And it drew me to the very foot of the cross.